Okay, so I just wanted to start maybe with a short meditation. Because I think meditation, the same way that the body has an effect when you exercise every day. You can exercise one day, the next day you'll have a little bit of pain in the muscle, the body, but then if you don't keep it up, then it's completely useless. Doesn't really make a difference. So the mind is the same. The mind works the same way. You have to be constant. Can everybody hear me properly? Yes? Hello? Yeah. So it has to be a constant. You can meditate maybe 10 minutes, 1 minute. 1 minute is good enough. 2 minutes, much better. If you can do 10 seconds, then you can do 1 minute, right? So we can start with 10 seconds and 1 minute, 2 minutes. 10 minutes every day is going to make a huge difference in your life. And of course, healthy mind, healthy body. So good food, you know, healthy food, healthy mind, the way we think, the intentions we have. The intention is very important. Everything starts with intention. Are you all familiar with karma, the concept of karma? So just to make it short, karma would be more like the law of cause and effect. It's like a universal law. Okay, it's like physics, but in a different aspect, in a more subtle kind of law. So basically, the intention is one of the main factors for the karma. So if you have a good intention, the result is going to be very different from, like, for example, egoist intention. If you are self-centered and you want your own happiness and the intention is me, I want to be happy, the result won't really be happiness, it will be more suffering. Why? Because we can never reach satisfaction with that intention. So if our intention is more like a selfless kind of intention, trying to help others, trying to be kind, trying to make others happy, even if it's just a smile, or maybe somebody's working and then you just ask them, how are you? When does your shift finish? You know, when did you start? Just like that, it makes them very happy, you know, because they're, oh, I matter. Especially in a big city, like Delhi or big cities like that. Most people, they don't even make eye contact. You know, everyone's so busy, self-centered in their own life and their stress. And of course, it's difficult. When you're stressed, to focus on other people is difficult because we really... And that's not really very healthy, you know? So it's important to just... I like the word shanti, shanti, right? So, just like a smile, a question, you know, thank you. It can have a big impact on somebody. You know, our mind is constantly changing. You know, so you have to observe that. I used to have that experience. We would have made, it would be a group photo. And then after, when they showed me the photo, the first thing I would look at, myself. Me. Big me, right? Oh, am I looking good or not? Then I look, oh no, I'm looking so bad. Immediately I'm so critical. And then I like put myself down. But maybe I look at the same photo a month later, or 5, 10 years later. I look at the photo, immediately I look at myself again. But the first thought, oh, I looked so good then. I don't look good now, so again, putting myself down. But the photo is exactly the same. What changed? My mind, my point of view, my perspective. So that's what we have to be always observing, the perspective. We conceptualize, we label, we condition. And that's something that's, it's in our nature, in a way. But as long as we're aware of it, then we can, you know, slowly work with it. So Lama Yeshe used to say always, observe your mind, observe your mind, observe your thoughts. So it's okay, you know, thoughts come and go, just like clouds. You can't really grab them, they're not really there. They come and go. So just think about it like clouds, right? Thoughts come, thoughts go. Don't get so attached to it. Don't believe your thoughts so much. You know, thoughts are not really based on reality. Our reality is just a perspective. The true reality has no color or form. We give it the color, we give it the form, we give it the meaning, we label it, and we believe it so much, and then we cling to it. We get so attached to the material world. But the material world is impermanent, it's changing constantly. How can you be attached to something that's changing constantly? You can never get to gravity. It's already changed. So it's good, just, you know, equanimity. That's equanimity is the main part of the vipassana. Has anyone done vipassana before? So vipassana, basically, there's a different courses. Some are 3 days, 5 days, maybe 10 days. The normal one is 10 days. And so basically, you keep silence for 10 days. You don't write, you don't read, you don't talk, and you meditate for maybe 10 hours every day. You eat very healthy food, vegetarian food, and it really helps. And basically, you just observe the breathing, this part here. At least at the beginning, that's what you do, to train your mind, to sharpen your mind, to see the subtlety of the mind. You know, because we're so, you know, like distracted every day, all the time, we don't really get a chance to interiorize and to observe that. So vipassana helps, meditation helps, to start to sharpen the mind, you know, it's like a knife, you know, you can sharpen the point. So when you, by the time of the fourth day when you're meditating, and just observing the breath coming in and coming out, and the feeling, the sensation here, you start to see, you know, how powerful the mind is, and how subtle it is. And that's just amazing. I really recommend, even if it's not vipassana, at least try to do that meditation of the day. 10 minutes, just observe the breath coming in and coming out. There's so many things that we don't observe. We get so absorbed in the outside world. We forget about the inner world. But the outside world is based from the inner world. We are the ones who give the meaning. We are the ones who give it the purpose. Right? So start within, and everything else will fall in place. Everything else will kind of have its meaning or understanding, you know? Go with the flow, they say. Don't try to force things or, you know, like that. Just let go. There's an exercise I really like. You breathe in. Try it again. One more time. How does that feel? Yeah. You can start your meditation like that in the morning if you want. Before you sleep also. I recommend morning. I mean, you can do morning or night or anytime you want. Meditation can be 24/7 if you want. Life is a meditation. Sometimes people think, oh, I can't meditate, it's too complicated, it's too difficult, it's not me, it's not part of me, I don't meditate. But if you think about it, the first 9 months of your life, you were in deep meditation. Then you're going to bring everybody down. Like the song, Don't Worry, Be Happy, right? You know that song? But even if you're unhappy, you're like, okay, I'm unhappy, but I want to share the good part of me. So you share that, and then you bring people up, and then you forget about your own suffering, your own problems. You know? If you think about it, I see it like this. If we were alone on the planet, we couldn't practice Dharma. If there's nobody, how can we practice Dharma? If there's nobody else? It's about sharing. Right? Life is about sharing. So we have to be grateful to everybody. We're all interdependent. Anyway, so let's go back to the meditation part. So yes, I highly recommend to train your mind slowly. Don't be too critical about yourself, just, you know. One of the meditations to train the monkey mind is to put your mind to work. So that's like vipassana, you know, just put your mind, just focus on the meditation, on the breath. The sensation that it gives of the air coming out, the sensation you get above your upper lip, and try to, because normally in our life we have attraction, rejection, or indifference, right? And the way we react creates a conditioning, and that conditioning becomes a habit. So we want to change that. So the training is basically to be equanimous. The more equanimous we are, the happier we are going to be. So basically to be equanimous towards the sensations that we receive. Does that make sense? It sounds simple, but when you put to practice it's quite complicated. But in the end it's very simple. So try to breathe instead of just from the nose like this. Instead of that one, try to breathe from here. The type of breathing you do when you do yoga. I don't know. Do many people do yoga here? Yes. So when you do yoga, you breathe from here. Just like this. And out is the same. Can you feel that? It's very different from the... Very different. Try it. And out is the same. That's the type of breathing we have when we're sleeping. When we're in the REM state, that's the breathing we have. When we're asleep, our eyes roll upwards. We're not aware of it. When you meditate also, the eyes roll upwards. So the posture is a choice, obviously. It's straight back. It's more helpful. It makes it easier for the channels. But you can do it lying down, you can do it when you're walking, when you're working, anytime, when you're sleeping. Meditation can be done in any situation. Because it's more about the attitude in life. The type of attitude. It's not so much, oh, I'm going to have to sit down and focus and concentrate and then, oh, and then get angry if my mind goes somewhere and have to bring it back again, you know. That's okay, it's normal, it happens. If thoughts come, let them come. Let them go. Just observe it. And then you observe your mind. Look where they come from. Why do they come? How do they come? The whole process. That's already meditation. It's called analytical meditation. Right? And then if you can try also to turn off the mind. Some people say, oh no, that's impossible. You can't do that. You can't not think. But when we fall asleep, we're not thinking. The mind shuts off. If the mind doesn't shut off, we can't fall asleep. Normally most of the people, before we go to sleep, we're thinking, and we can't fall asleep because we're thinking. And then finally we get so tired, and then we fall asleep like automatically, quack, right? But if you manually turn your mind off, and then you slowly go into the sleep state, then you can observe how you're going to the sleep state, you know? It's like moving from one room to another. And each room becomes like a deeper kind of feeling. And there's one room where we can't remember what was in that room. And then suddenly the next room we are in the dream state. We can remember dreams. Everybody can remember. It's just a question of believing or trying or focusing or... Just the fact that we think, oh, I want to remember my dream. The subconscious is going to hear that and that's going to probably trigger the fact that we'll be able to remember the next day. Nothing is impossible, right? Just have to believe it and move forward. Don't put yourself down. Don't think like that. Don't think, you know, oh, it's impossible, it's so difficult, oh, I can't do it, I'm not good enough. That kind of thinking is not really healthy. You know, you shouldn't think like that. You should think, like they talk about Dharma, and Dharma they say like that. They say, everybody has the potential of a Buddha. We all have the seed. The tree, right? So you look at the seed, it looks very small, but actually it can be a huge Bodhi tree. And the whole, this big Bodhi tree is all inside one little seed. So it's a little bit like that. The potential is there. We just need the right condition. And that's why. It's never too late. So you can start today if you want. Otherwise tomorrow. Even though tomorrow never comes. In Spanish we have this saying, you know, tomorrow. Tomorrow never arrives. It's always tomorrow. So let's start today. So, decision making, I don't know what to talk about decision making. So, I mean, it's very complex, this subject, decision making. I feel, for me personally, I'm going to talk from my own experience, okay? When I get to a crossing, roads crossing, oh, I have to choose left, I have to choose right, or because life is like that sometimes. Or at least, yeah, we think oh, you know, did I make the right decision? Or what should I do? And then we get all stressed. So for me, decision making is more about, okay, we have to use the logic, but we can also use the heart and the guts, right? The indigenous people, they're very wise, much wiser than us today. With all the technology in the world, you know, without the phone, without the computer, without the house, if they drop us in the middle of the forest, we'll be very difficult to survive. We're not prepared, mentally or physically. But the indigenous people, you know, they say, the aborigines from Australia, they have a saying, they say, we have three brains. The first brain is the gut, the stomach, the intuition. Second brain, the heart, the love, and the caring. And then the third brain, the logic, right? Decision making. But where do you start? You start from the intuition, from the heart. And then you decide with the mind or the brain or whatever you want to call it. So when you have to make a decision, the best option would be to sit down. Sit down, relax, and the answer will come to you. Shut up your mind, don't stress so much, it will come to you. And then you can make the right decision. There's no really right or wrong, you know, this. You know, once you make a choice, that's it, you move forward. If you focus on the wound, you know, you're just going to have your baggage, you're going to have a backpack that you're going to have to be carrying all the time. Oh, this happened to me, why make a bad decision? You know, and you just worry about it. If you can't change it, why worry about it, right? And if you focus on the lesson, then it's useful, you can move forward, you know? As long as you don't repeat it. You can repeat it a couple times, you know? It's okay. But at least use it as a lesson, use it as a stepping stone to move forward. Don't keep repeating the same mistake. And if you make a mistake, it's okay. That's how we learn making mistakes. That's the best way of learning. If we don't make mistakes, it means we are not really doing anything, right? So anyways, decision making, you know, don't be hard on yourself. You know, just use it, use everything as a stepping stone, as a means of moving forward and evolving. If something bad happens to you and you're able to overcome it, think like this, think like, oh, I overcame it, so I have the experience, I can share it with other people so I can help them to overcome it too. And in that way, it becomes a lesson instead of a wound. Right? So focus on the lesson. And don't worry, we all make mistakes, it's fine, it doesn't matter. It's okay, it's normal. That's how we learn. This is a school, you know, Earth, humanity, it's a school. It's just a process to improve. Okay, number two, purpose finding. So like, as I mentioned before, we're all trying to find our purpose. We're all trying to understand, what are we doing here? Why are we here? Who are we? That's it, I think we all have asked that question since a very young age. And I think, you know, Dharma helps us to understand that, you know, our own true nature. The more we investigate, the more we observe, the more we really look inside, the more we understand. And it's not so much an intellectual understanding, of course that's a part of it, but the real understanding, it's an experience. You know, there could be 100 books explaining the taste of chocolate. But until we don't taste it, it doesn't really matter whether we read the 100 books or not. We have to taste the chocolate in order to really understand. And once we've tasted it, nobody can take that away from you. You know it. It's like riding a bicycle. You know, muscle memory. Once you ride a bicycle, even if you don't ride it after 10 years, you pick up a bicycle, automatic, easy. Because you've experienced it. You can read about, oh, how to ride a bicycle. Until you don't ride it, it's not really going to be that useful. You can have an idea, a preconception, but it's not the same thing. So that's why meditation is a key. You know? And that key, that it's been passed on from generation to generation. We're so lucky. Since the time of the Buddha, even before that, you know, people have experienced it. They reached realizations and they shared that with us. And that has been passed on. And we live at this time with His Holiness the Dalai Lama. At the same time, there's nothing more lucky than that. You know, we are so fortunate. We're living in the golden age. Some people tell me, oh, these are degenerated times. I don't think so, you know. I think we're in a golden age. We focus on the negative thing. We give more importance to that. And then the positive things, we don't give so much importance. So in the end, we get stuck with the negative things. Oh, that's so weak. You know, if you turn on the news many times, you know, you see that, you know, the news. If the news was only good, maybe they wouldn't sell newspapers. People wouldn't watch news, you know. It's like, somehow we're wired that way, you know. I don't know why, but it's like that. I like to use an example, you know. For example, a mother that raised her children, you know, 5 children by herself, working 2 jobs, raising her children, put them to university, 20, 30 years, will she come out in the headlines of the newspaper? Probably not. Single mother raises 5 children, passes them to university. Wow. It's not in the newspaper. Single mother kills her child. Boom, headlines. Like that, in 1 second, gone. It's so difficult to create, to build, but to destroy, boom, in 1 second. And then you can kill an ant like that, boom, but can you put the ant together again? No. Do we have that power? No. We think we're powerful because we can kill a mosquito like that? That's, you know, but put back the mosquito together again. It's millions of years of evolution. I mean, we're quite insignificant, you know. We think we're the center of the universe. We're not. We're the center of us, yeah, okay. We live in our body. Our perspective is based from our own thoughts and our own experience and our own childhood. But in the end, we're insignificant. And that's, you know, you have to understand that. There's a saying I like to say, be proud because you are. Right? So be proud. It's good to be proud. It's good to be, say, okay, I am, I have the potential of the Buddha. You know? But then also be humble because you belong. So keep the balance. It's always about the balance. Don't go from one extreme to another. My father used to say, with moderation, everything is okay. Without moderation, everything is not okay. Even water. Water can kill you if you drink too much. So, anyways. Purpose finding. So it's a challenge. And it's our lifelong challenge to understand our purpose. But I believe that our purpose is to help others to find their own true nature. But for that, we have to find our own true nature first. So that's the job. From the individual level. So instead of trying to change the world, change yourself. Understand yourself. Find yourself. Once you do that, then you can share that. And you probably will also influence the collective memory. Just the fact that you're at peace with yourself, that you're happy, you're going to affect that. Even if you don't see it. It's like the butterfly effect, you know? So for me, personally, I feel that's in a way our purpose. You know, to find, understand our true nature, to work on that, and then to be able to share that with others. Anyway, but we all have to find our own purpose, right? Dharma, or the Guru, is a little bit like a lighthouse. You know, a lighthouse is, the purpose of the lighthouse is to warn us if we are a boat. Okay, so think. We're a boat and we're the captain of our boats. You know, we're the captain of our boat. Sometimes we're not even the captain, we just let the boat drift. And then if the waves go, the wind goes this way, we go that way. The wind goes this way. So first step one, be the captain of the boat. Take your life in your own hands. You are responsible for your own life. Nobody else. You can't blame others. Oh, is this such and such person's fault? Oh, this happened to me, I can't do anything about it. No. You are responsible for your life. You're responsible. Okay, so first of all, be the captain of your boat. And then you decide which direction you want to go. So the lighthouse, it helps us, right? It warns us, don't come near the rocks here. You'll get shipwrecked. And it also says, oh, the point is that way. So it's an orientation. So if you think about people, I like to call it spiritual bypassing. it's like you have your own traumas, you have your own conflicts, right? And then you don't really want to challenge that. You don't really want to, like, you know, look at that. You're scared of you know, what do you call it? Like inner conflict, or you're scared of challenging that. You're scared of confronting your own fears. You're scared of your own potential. You know, so you do a spiritual bypassing. Oh, well, or religion, or music, or any kind of passion like that, or whatever it is. And then we just focus on that to try to avoid really interiorizing, challenging ourselves, and confronting our own fears. But Maharaj used to think, so he used to sing that, you know? You can't really run away from yourself, right? There's this song, you can't run away from yourself. And it's true. We're born alone, we die alone. It's up to us. And on the way, we're going to have a lot of help, a lot of support. But we have to be aware of that. We can't be attached to, oh, you know, I want company, or I need help. Of course we need help. But it starts from us. We are the ones who have to decide to be the captain of our boat and choose the direction we want. So the lighthouse is there to help us, orient us. But we're not going to the lighthouse, right? We're not going to, you know, okay, oh, Dharma, that's everything, it's going to save me. The Guru is going to save me. If all spiritual bypassing, you know, if you're going to use that, at least use it also to work on your own traumas, confront yourself. And use it as a means to improve. Don't be scared of your potential. Believe in yourself. We have the seed of the Buddha, you know. And in Dharma, many times you visualize you are the Guru and the Guru is you. Why? Because that helps you to really believe in yourself. You know, and the mind is such a powerful tool. You look just in this room, everything here started with a thought. You know, how it's been put together. You know, even the arrangement of the flowers started with a thought. You know, so or the buildings, the planes, technology, science, wars, countries, governments, everything started with a thought originally. So that's how powerful thoughts are. You know, so be aware of your thoughts. Very important. Your thoughts have a huge impact, a huge effect. So, anyways, for me that's a purpose. I think it's a good enough purpose. It will bring us happiness. You take care of others, you take care of yourself. Purpose is to improve yourself, find your own true nature in order to be able to share that with others. It's a good enough purpose, but each person has to find their own purpose. It's just an idea.